The X-Zone radio and TV show is largely an opinion talk show. All opinions, comments, or statements of fact expressed by Rob McConnell's guests are strictly their own and are not to be construed as those of the X-Zone radio and TV show or in any manner endorsed by Rob McConnell, Realmar McConnell Media Company, Talkstar Radio Network, its affiliated stations, or employees.
All-Hit Radio.
Welcome to the X-Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
Well, excuse me, but I think you've got my chair. No, that one's not taken, I don't mind if you sit here. I'll be glad to
show. I just couldn't help that one. X-Zone Nation, the chair by George Strait. It reminds me of watching Clint Eastwood talking to a chair at the RNC a couple of weeks ago. I think Dirty Harry went Batty Harry. Well, that's just my own personal opinion, but you know, who knows? Who really knows? Well, my guest this hour just might have the inside scoop on what that was all about, X-Zone Nation. Morrow Wilson is my special guest, and he is a direct descendant of both the Declaration of Independence signer and the United States Constitution. Morrow Wilson graduated from the Putney School and from Columbia College, where he studied English and American literature with, among others, Mark Van Dorn and Lionel Trilling. His father was a writer and protege of Theodore Dreiser, yeah, author of some three dozen books, as well as articles in every major American magazine, and a reporter for the Arkansas Gazette, the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, and the New York Times. Now, my guest this hour is Morrow Wilson, and as I said, he's the celebrated journalist and son of and author Charles Wilson. And he's an award-winning career personnel as an actor, writer, and cable television chief. And now he reaches a new plateau, X-Zone Nation, with his latest novel, David Sunshine. Joining me now is Morrow Wilson. And Morrow, welcome to the X-Zone.
Well, thank you so much, Rob. Great pleasure to be here.
The chair, what was the story behind Clint Eastwood and, talking to an invisible party on the chair?
Well, I will tell you, it's a very old acting exercise, and it's a very old vaudeville routine. It's been practiced for, gosh, I suppose a couple of centuries. And the idea is you do what Clint did. And I must tell you that I was not offended. I mean, I thought that when he came out at the beginning, I thought he was pretty funny. I thought he'd begin to kind of go a little vague toward the second half of it, but I enjoyed it. I think what the Republicans wanted, and I think at the convention, and I think they were probably right to want it, was just a little comic break, you know, before they, because it had been so serious, and they'd been talking about, you know, such profound issues and patriotism and freedom and the Republican philosophy and all of these things are not leavened by much humor, you know, and so here came Clint to give him just a little break of comic relief before they got into, if I'm not mistaken, Governor Romney's important speech, and I think it backfired for a lot of the media who didn't understand it and who seemed to be outraged by it. But as a guy who's looking at conventions and maybe is a little bit of a news junkie and I'm very interested in politics because it's kind of my family store. You know, you mentioned my illustrious ancestor who was on the Supreme Court and all that stuff. And to me, I just thought, well, this is what he's trying to do, and I give him a B+. I mean, I thought he did okay. You may not feel that way.
Oh, no. Listen, I love Clint. I think he's an icon. I've seen every Dirty Harry movie. I've seen every movie that he's ever been in. Love the good old spaghetti westerns, where he was the only person who you could actually look at the lips and listen to the words and everything was in total sync.
True. And remember him back in the days of Rawhide?
Oh, my heavens, yep.
Yeah, he's one of those guys who, very rare, I think, in the show business, a guy whose career really is 50 years. I mean, you don't see very many people like that.
My friend, please stand by. Morrow Wilson is my guest this hour, Exonation. And his website is www.davidsunshinethenewnovel.com. And when we come back from this commercial break in 2 minutes, we're going to be talking more about the media. We're going to be talking to Morrow about his role throughout the years in the media. And we'll also be talking to him about his late ex-wife. And we're going to keep that as a cliffhanger. My name is Rob McConnell. This is The X-Zone. We'll be back on the other side of this 2 minute commercial break as we continue from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Don't go away.
And could I talk you out of a lie? Well, thank you. Could I drink you?
I don't know, for some reason I feel like a cigar, a shot of bourbon, and spaghetti. What is it with that song? No idea.
Speaking of Clint Eastwood,
Morrow Wilson is our special guest this hour, X-Zone Nation. We're talking about Morrow's new book entitled David Sunshine. His website is www.davidsunshinethenewnovel.com. I understand that you actually wrote David Sunshine as a contemporary expose. Two questions for you, Morrow. Why wasn't it published then, and why is it published now, 40 years later?
Good. Good question. When it was first written, which was in the 60s, mm-hmm. Very close to the adventures that it describes, there was a publisher who took it, gave me what in those days would be called a princely advance, and then at the last minute backed out, was in breach of contract. And this didn't necessarily make me miserable, because everyone loves to be the second person to discover you, so literary agents began to descend on me and say, we can sell it, and they couldn't. And then word got back to me that... this actually was a dangerous book, because the people in the book were very obvious. I mean, it's a novel, but mm-hmm. as you say at the beginning of where fiction is fact and fact is fiction, it was like that. So they said, well, it'll be very obvious, transparently obvious who these people are. They're going to sue us, and I said, well, but everything here is true. I mean, even down to the dialogue. They're not going to have a leg to stand on. I mean, why don't you just... And anyway, how shall I say, more cautious heads prevailed. So I just found that... And by the way, I don't happen to think that was the reason. I think the reason was that at that time, the man who was being parodied in my book mm-hmm. Was so powerful, such an important force in television at that time, that people were just going along with the trend. I mean, if the New Yorker was writing a profile of him, if the New York Times was putting our show on the front page every Monday morning after it was broadcast, don't mess around with the common wisdom. So I think that was essentially it. They didn't want to. No one was really interested in seeing this icon made fun of. Now, within a matter, really, of a very short period of time, his true colors began to show, and pretty soon he became a joke. But by then, my book was safely ensconced in the drawer, and it really wasn't exactly current, and I was kind of discouraged. So, but the other day, the other day, I mean, really the other month, not very long ago, this very year, I just, you know, I opened it up, the drawer, I opened up the box, I dusted it off, I looked at it, and I said, yeah, that's a pretty good book. I think you should try to publish it.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, at this point, it had aged from being a contemporary expose to being historical fiction, you know, because none of the people and the events that it was recounting were around anymore.
Right.
So that's why it almost got published then, which would have really made a great change in my life and in a lot of ways, but it didn't. And so I just thought, let's publish it now. And my surprise has been, I really mean this without any false modesty or anything, that I didn't expect any particular interest in it. I mean, it's a nice, it's really, really a good book. I say that as the author. But of course, I'm prejudiced.
Sure.
But people suddenly, I mean, I have had, you know, people wanting review copies like crazy, and good people like you calling up and saying, let's do an interview, and I'm flabbergasted and very, very happy about the way things are going. So at least so far. I mean, who knows? It may all just grind to a halt one of these minutes. But so far, it seems to be building. So I'm pleased.
Tell me, you know, you've been in the media industry, advertising industry, for a number of years now.
Yes.
How have you seen the change of all the multiple channels that are available, and the, in my opinion, the decrease in quality programming?
Yeah, well, I think your opinion is absolutely correct. I mean, I think if we look at television, in a way, that's part of what the novel is about, because the novel is the story of a lick, this raw-boned, mm-hmm. Very innocent, sort of college football hero who comes to New York from Arkansas to, you know, completely innocent. He wants to make his way, because at that point, it's the 60s, and the golden age of television, so-called, that is the 50s,
yeah.
When you had all these wonderful actors, you know, James Dean, Paul Newman, Charlton Heston, Rod Steiger, Jerry yeah. Woodward, Steve McQueen, all these people were working on television. Paddy Chayefsky was writing, Rod Serling was writing, Robert Allen Arthur was writing, these wonderful, you know, television was a whole sort of creative renaissance. But, of course, it was kind of still a second-class citizen. People would say, well, I don't do television. You know, yeah. Actors would say that. But what happened, of course, is that there came this time when that golden age was kind of beginning to, the sun was setting on that, and my hero walks into it at just that moment, and he goes to work for the guy who is the most highly thought of, highly respected, idealized producer in all of television. He also happens to run a talk show, so his face and name are very familiar to people. And this guy walks into this world where he thinks this guy is quality television. I mean, PBS hadn't even started. You know, hadn't even really, really gotten started up. Mm-hmm. And this is the guy who's going to make it all continue, the golden age. But the guy turns out to be exactly the opposite of what he appears. And that's the beginning of the story.